This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: The Theory of Spectra and Atomic Constitution, 3 Essays. By Niels Henrik David Bohr. Preface: The three essays which here appear in English all deal with the application of the quantum theory to problems of atomic structure and refer to the different stages in the development of this theory. The first essay, On the Spectrum of Hydrogen, is a translation of a Danish address given before the Physical Society of Copenhagen on the 20th of December 1913 and printed in Fysisk Tidsskrift She, 1914. Although this address was delivered at a time when the formal development of the quantum theory was only at its beginning, the reader will find the general trend of thought very similar to that expressed in the later addresses, which form the other two essays. As emphasized at several points, the theory does not attempt an explanation in the usual sense of this word, but only the establishment of a connection between facts, which in the present state of science are unexplained, that is to say, the usual physical conceptions do not offer sufficient basis for a detailed description. The second essay, On the Series Spectra of the Elements, is a translation of a German address given before the Physical Society of Berlin on the 27th of April 1920 and printed in Zeitschrift für Dyrrhesusar Physik V, 1920. This address falls into two main parts. The considerations in the first part are closely related to the contents of the first essay. Especially, no use is made of the new formal conceptions established through the later development of the quantum theory. The second part contains a survey of the results reached by this development. An attempt is made to elucidate the problems by means of a general principle, which postulates a formal correspondence between the fundamentally different conceptions of the classical electrodynamics and those of the quantum theory. The first germ of this correspondence principle may be found in the first essay, in the deduction of the expression for the constant of the hydrogen spectrum in terms of Planck's constant and of the quantities which in Rutherford's atomic model are necessary for the description of the hydrogen atom. The third essay, The Structure of the Atom and the Physical and Chemical Properties of the Elements, is based on a Danish address given before a joint meeting of the Physical and Chemical Societies of Copenhagen on the 18th of October 1921 and printed in Fysisk Tidsskrift She, 1921. While the first two essays form verbal translations of the respective addresses, this essay differs from the Danish original in certain minor points. Besides the addition of a few new figures with explanatory text, certain passages dealing with problems discussed in the second essay are left out, and some remarks about recent contributions to the subject are inserted. Where such insertions have been introduced will clearly appear from the text. This essay is divided into four parts. The first two parts contain a survey of previous results concerning atomic problems and a short account of the theoretical ideas of the quantum theory. In the following parts, it is shown how these ideas lead to a view of atomic constitution which seems to offer an explanation of the observed physical and chemical properties of the elements, and especially to bring the characteristic features of the periodic table into close connection with the interpretation of the optical and high-frequency spectra of the elements. For the convenience of the reader, all three essays are subdivided into smaller paragraphs, each with a headline. Conforming to the character of the essays, there is, however, no question of anything like a full account or even a proportionate treatment of the subject stated in these headlines, the principal object being to emphasize certain general views in a freer form than is usual in scientific treatises or textbooks. For the same reason, no detailed references to the literature are given, although an attempt is made to mention the main contributions to the development of the subject. As regards further information, the reader in the case of the second essay is referred to a larger treatise on the quantum theory of line spectra, two parts of which have appeared in the Transactions of the Copenhagen Academy, DKGL. Donsky Vidensk. Selska. Skrifter 8. Ryak IV. 1 I and 2, 1918, asterisk operator where full references to the literature may be found. The proposed continuation of this treatise, mentioned at several places in the second essay, has for various reasons been delayed, but in the near future, the work will be completed by the publication of a third part. It is my intention to deal more fully with the problems discussed in the third essay by a larger, systematic account of the application of the quantum theory to atomic problems, which is under preparation. As mentioned both in the beginning and at the end of the third essay, the considerations which it contains are clearly still incomplete in character. This holds not only as regards the elaboration of details, but also as regards the development of the theoretical ideas. It may be useful once more to emphasize that although the word explanation has been used more liberally than, for instance, in the first essay, we are not concerned with a description of the phenomena based on a well-defined physical picture. It may rather be said that hitherto every progress in the problem of atomic structure has tended to emphasize the well-known mysteries of the quantum theory more and more. I hope the exposition in these essays is sufficiently clear, nevertheless, to give the reader an impression of the peculiar charm which the study of atomic physics possesses just on this account. I wish to express my best thanks to Dr. A.D. Udden, University of Pennsylvania, who has undertaken the translation of the original addresses into English, and to Mr. C.D. Ellis, Trinity College, Cambridge, who has looked through the manuscript and suggested many valuable improvements in the exposition of the subject. Copenhagen, May 1922. N. Bohr. Essay 1, On the Spectrum of Hydrogen. Empirical Spectral Laws. Hydrogen possesses not only the smallest atomic weight of all the elements, but it also occupies a peculiar position both with regard to its physical and its chemical properties. One of the points where this becomes particularly apparent is the hydrogen line spectrum. The spectrum of hydrogen observed in an ordinary Geissler tube consists of a series of lines, the strongest of which lies at the red end of the spectrum, while the others extend out into the ultraviolet, the distance between the various lines, as well as their intensities, constantly decreasing. In the ultraviolet, the series converges to a limit. Bohr, as we know, discovered, 1885, that it was possible to represent the wavelengths of these lines very accurately by the simple law. 1. Where R is a constant and N is a whole number. The wavelengths of the five strongest hydrogen lines, corresponding to N equals 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, measured in air at ordinary pressure, and address delivered before the Physical Society in Copenhagen, December 20, 1913. Temperature and the values of these wavelengths multiplied are given in the following table. The table shows that the product is nearly constant, while the deviations are not greater than might be ascribed to experimental errors. As you already know, Balmer's discovery of the law relating to the hydrogen spectrum led to the discovery of laws applying to the spectra of other elements. The most important work in this connection was done by Rydberg, 1890, and Ritz, 1908. Rydberg pointed out that the spectra of many elements contain series of lines whose wavelengths are given approximately by the formula. Where A and alpha are constants having different values for the various series, while R is a universal constant equal to the constant in the spectrum of hydrogen. If the wavelengths are measured in vacuo, Rydberg calculated the value of R to be 109,675. In the spectra of many elements, as opposed to the simple spectrum of hydrogen, there are several series of lines whose wavelengths are to a close approximation given by Rydberg's formula if different values are assigned to the constants A and alpha, Rydberg showed, however, in his earliest work, that certain relations existed between the constants in the various series of the spectrum of one and the same element. These relations were later very successfully generalized by Ritz through the establishment of the combination principle. According to this principle, the wavelengths of the various lines in the spectrum of an element may be expressed by the formula. In this formula, N1 and N2 are whole numbers, and F1N, F2N is a series of functions of N which may be written approximately. Where R is Rydberg's universal constant, and alpha R is a constant which is different for the different functions. A particular spectral line will, according to this principle, correspond to each combination of N1 and N2, as well as to the functions F1, F2. The establishment of this principle led therefore to the prediction of a great number of lines which were not included in the spectral formulae previously considered, and in a large number of cases, the calculations were found to be in close agreement with the experimental observations. In the case of hydrogen, Ritz assumed that formula 1 was a special case of the general formula 3, and therefore predicted, among other things, a series of lines in the infrared given by the formula. In 1909, Passion succeeded in observing the first two lines of this series corresponding to N equals 4 and N equals 5. The part played by hydrogen in the development of our knowledge of the spectral laws is not solely due to its ordinary simple spectrum, but it can also be traced in other less direct ways. At a time when Rydberg's laws were still in want of further confirmation, Pickering, 1897, found in the spectrum of a star a series of lines whose wavelengths showed a very simple relation to the ordinary hydrogen spectrum, since to a very close approximation they could be expressed by the formula. Rydberg considered these lines to represent a new series of lines in the spectrum of hydrogen, and predicted, according to his theory, the existence of still another series of hydrogen lines, the wavelengths of which would be given by. By examining earlier observations, it was actually found that a line had been observed in the spectrum of certain stars which coincided closely with the first line in this series, corresponding to N equals 2. From analogy with other spectra, it was also to be expected that this would be the strongest line. This was regarded as a great triumph for Rydberg's theory, and tended to remove all doubt that the new spectrum was actually due to hydrogen. Rydberg's view has therefore been generally accepted by physicists up to the present moment. Recently, however, the question has been reopened, and Fowler, 1912, has succeeded in observing the Pickering lines in ordinary laboratory experiments. We shall return to this question again later. The discovery of these beautiful and simple laws concerning the line spectra of the elements has naturally resulted in many attempts at a theoretical explanation. Such attempts are very alluring because the simplicity of the spectral laws and the exceptional accuracy with which they apply appear to promise that the correct explanation will be very simple and will give valuable information about the properties of matter. I should like to consider some of these theories somewhat more closely, several of which are extremely interesting and have been developed with the greatest keenness and ingenuity, but unfortunately space does not permit me to do so here. I shall have to limit myself to the statement that not one of the theories so far proposed appears to offer a satisfactory or even a plausible way of explaining the laws of the line spectra. Considering our deficient knowledge of the laws which determine the processes inside atoms, it is scarcely possible to give an explanation of the kind attempted in these theories. The inadequacy of our ordinary theoretical conceptions has become especially apparent from the important results which have been obtained in recent years from the theoretical and experimental study of the laws of temperature radiation. You will therefore understand that I shall not attempt to propose an explanation of the spectral laws. On the contrary, I shall try to indicate a way in which it appears possible to bring the spectral laws into close connection with other properties of the elements, which appear to be equally inexplicable on the basis of the present state of the science. In these considerations, I shall employ the results obtained from the study of temperature radiation, as well as the view of atomic structure, which has been reached by the study of the radioactive elements. Laws of temperature radiation. I shall commence by mentioning the conclusions which have been drawn from experimental and theoretical work on temperature radiation. Let us consider an enclosure surrounded by bodies which are in temperature equilibrium. In this space, there will be a certain amount of energy contained in the rays emitted by the surrounding substances and crossing each other in every direction. By making the assumption that the temperature equilibrium will not be disturbed by the mutual radiation of the various bodies, Kirchhoff, 1860, showed that the amount of energy per unit volume, as well as the distribution of this energy among the various wavelengths, is independent of the form and size of the space and of the nature of the surrounding bodies, and depends only on the temperature. Kirchhoff's result has been confirmed by experiment, and the amount of energy and its distribution among the various wavelengths, and the manner in which it depends on the temperature, are now fairly well known from a great amount of experimental work. Or, as it is usually expressed, we have a fairly accurate experimental knowledge of the laws of temperature radiation. Kirchhoff's considerations were only capable of predicting the existence of a law of temperature radiation, and many physicists have subsequently attempted to find a more thorough explanation of the experimental results. You will perceive that the electromagnetic theory of light, together with the electron theory, suggests a method of solving this problem. According to the electron theory of matter, a body consists of a system of electrons. By making certain definite assumptions concerning the forces acting on the electrons, it is possible to calculate their motion, and consequently the energy radiated from the body per second in the form of electromagnetic oscillations of various wavelengths. In a similar manner, the absorption of rays of a given wavelength by a substance can be determined by calculating the effect of electromagnetic oscillations upon the motion of the electrons. Having investigated the emission and absorption of a body at all temperatures and for rays of all wavelengths, it is possible, as Kirchhoff has shown, to determine immediately the laws of temperature radiation. Since the result is to be independent of the nature of the body, we are justified in expecting an agreement with experiment, even though very special assumptions are made about the forces acting upon the electrons of the hypothetical substance. This naturally simplifies the problem considerably, but it is nevertheless sufficiently difficult, and it is remarkable that it has been possible to make any advance at all in this direction. As is well known, this has been done by Lorentz, 1903. He calculated the emissive as well as the absorptive power of a metal for long wavelengths, using the same assumptions about the motions of the electrons in the metal that Drude, 1900, employed in his calculation of the ratio of the electrical and thermal conductivities. Subsequently, by calculating the ratio of the emissive to the absorptive power, Lorentz really obtained an expression for the law of temperature radiation, which for long wavelengths agrees remarkably well with experimental facts. In spite of this beautiful and promising result, it has nevertheless become apparent that the electromagnetic theory is incapable of explaining the law of temperature radiation. For it is possible to show that if the investigation is not confined to oscillations of long wavelengths, as in Lorentz's work, but is also extended to oscillations corresponding to small wavelengths, results are obtained which are contrary to experiment. This is especially evident from Jean's investigations, 1905, in which he employed a very interesting statistical method first proposed by Lord Rayleigh. We are therefore compelled to assume that the classical electrodynamics does not agree with reality, or expressed more carefully, that it cannot be employed in calculating the absorption and emission of radiation by atoms. Fortunately, the law of temperature radiation has also successfully indicated the direction in which the necessary changes in the electrodynamics are to be sought. Even before the appearance of the papers by Lorentz and Jeans, Planck, 1900, had derived theoretically a formula for the black body radiation, which was in good agreement with the results of experiment. Planck did not limit himself exclusively to the classical electrodynamics, but introduced the further assumption that a system of oscillating electrical particles, elementary resonators, will neither radiate nor absorb energy continuously, as required by the ordinary electrodynamics, but on the contrary will radiate and absorb discontinuously. The energy contained within the system at any moment is always equal to a whole multiple of the so-called quantum of energy, the magnitude of which is equal to h nu, where h is Planck's constant and nu is the frequency of oscillation of the system per second. In formal respects, Planck's theory leaves much to be desired. In certain calculations, the ordinary electrodynamics is used, while in others assumptions distinctly at variance with it are introduced without any attempt being made to show that it is possible to give a consistent explanation of the procedure used. Planck's theory would hardly have acquired general recognition merely on the ground of its agreement with experiments on black body radiation. But as you know, the theory has also contributed quite remarkably to the elucidation of many different physical phenomena, such as specific heats, photoelectric effect, X-rays, and the absorption of heat rays by gases. These explanations involve more than the qualitative assumption of a discontinuous transformation of energy, for with the aid of Planck's constant H, it seems to be possible, at least approximately, to account for a great number of phenomena about which nothing could be said previously. It is therefore hardly too early to express the opinion that, whatever the final explanation will be, the discovery of energy quanta must be considered as one of the most important results arrived at in physics, and must be taken into consideration in investigations of the properties of atoms, and particularly in connection with any explanation of the spectral laws in which such phenomena as the emission and absorption of electromagnetic radiation are concerned. The nuclear theory of the atom. We shall now consider the second part of the foundation on which we shall build, namely the conclusions arrived at from experiments with the rays emitted by radioactive substances. I have previously here in the Physical Society had the opportunity of speaking of the scattering of alpha rays in passing through thin plates, and to mention how Rutherford, 1911, has proposed a theory for the structure of the atom in order to explain the remarkable and unexpected results of these experiments. I shall, therefore, only remind you that the characteristic feature of Rutherford's theory is the assumption of the existence of a positively charged nucleus inside the atom. A number of electrons are supposed to revolve in closed orbits around the nucleus, the number of these electrons being sufficient to neutralize the positive charge of the nucleus. The dimensions of the nucleus are supposed to be very small in comparison with the dimensions of the orbits of the electrons, and almost the entire mass of the atom is supposed to be concentrated in the nucleus. According to Rutherford's calculation, the positive charge of the nucleus corresponds to a number of electrons equal to about half the atomic weight. This number coincides approximately with the number of the particular element in the periodic system, and it is therefore natural to assume that the number of electrons in the atom is exactly equal to this number. This hypothesis, which was first stated by van den Broek, 1912, opens the possibility of obtaining a simple explanation of the periodic system. This assumption is strongly confirmed by experiments on the elements of small atomic weight. In the first place, it is evident that according to Rutherford's theory, the alpha particle is the same as the nucleus of a helium atom. Since the alpha particle has a double positive charge, it follows immediately that a neutral helium atom contains two electrons. Further, the concordant results obtained from calculations based on experiments as different as the diffuse scattering of X-rays and the decrease in velocity of alpha rays in passing through matter render the conclusion extremely likely that a hydrogen atom contains only a single electron. This agrees most beautifully with the fact that J.J. Thomson, in his well-known experiments on rays of positive electricity, has never observed a hydrogen atom with more than a single positive charge, while all other elements investigated may have several charges. Let us now assume that a hydrogen atom simply consists of an electron revolving around a nucleus of equal and opposite charge, and of a mass which is very large in comparison with that of the electron. It is evident that this assumption may explain the peculiar position already referred to which hydrogen occupies among the elements, but it appears at the outset completely hopeless to attempt to explain anything at all of the special properties of hydrogen, still less its line spectrum, on the basis of considerations relating to such a simple system. Let us assume, for the sake of brevity, that the mass of the nucleus is infinitely large in proportion to that of the electron, and that the velocity of the electron is very small in comparison with that of light. If we now temporarily disregard the energy radiation, which according to the ordinary electrodynamics will accompany the accelerated motion of the electron, the latter, in accordance with Kepler's first law, will describe an ellipse with the nucleus in one of the foci, denoting the frequency of revolution by omega, and the major axis of the ellipse by 2a, we find that where E is the charge of the electron and M its mass, while W is the work which must be added to the system in order to remove the electron to an infinite distance from the nucleus. These expressions are extremely simple, and they show that the magnitude of the frequency of revolution, as well as the length of the major axis, depend only on W, and are independent of the eccentricity of the orbit. By varying W, we may obtain all possible values for omega and 2a. This condition shows, however, that it is not possible to employ the above formulae directly in calculating the orbit of the electron in a hydrogen atom. For this, it will be necessary to assume that the orbit of the electron cannot take on all values, and in any event, the line spectrum clearly indicates that the oscillations of the electron cannot vary continuously between wide limits. The impossibility of making any progress with a simple system like the one considered here might have been foretold from a consideration of the dimensions involved. For with the aid of E and M alone, it is impossible to obtain a quantity which can be interpreted as a diameter of an atom or as a frequency. If we attempt to account for the radiation of energy in the manner required by the ordinary electrodynamics, it will only make matters worse. As a result of the radiation of energy, W would continually increase, and the above expressions, 4, show that at the same time the frequency of revolution of the system would increase, and the dimensions of the orbit decrease. This process would not stop until the particles had approached so closely to one another that they no longer attracted each other. The quantity of energy which would be radiated away before this happened would be very great. If we were to treat these particles as geometrical points, this energy would be infinitely great, and with the dimensions of the electrons as calculated from their mass, about 10^-13 centimeters, and of the nucleus as calculated by Rutherford, about 10^-12 centimeters, this energy would be many times greater than the energy changes with which we are familiar in ordinary atomic processes. It can be seen that it is impossible to employ Rutherford's atomic model so long as we confine ourselves exclusively to the ordinary electrodynamics. but this is nothing more than might have been expected. As I have mentioned, we may consider it to be an established fact that it is impossible to obtain a satisfactory explanation of the experiments on temperature radiation with the aid of electrodynamics, no matter what atomic model be employed. The fact that the deficiencies of the atomic model we are considering stand out so plainly.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.